Good evening. My name is Peter Schumacher. I'm the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, and I have the honor of saying a few words about the Obelger Institute, as well as a few words about our distinguished speaker tonight. The Charles and Joan Obelger Entire Studies Institute is one of several key components of Seton Hall's extensive Italian Studies initiatives. In collaboration with the Joseph and Geraldine LaMotta Chair in Italian Studies and the Valente Family Italian Library, the Obelger Institute coordinates the university's many activities relating to the promoting and sustaining Italian and Italian-American history and culture. And if you've been paying attention to the university webpage, you know that Professor William Connell, Bill Connell, is the recent recipient of a Carnegie Fellowship, which is an extremely prestigious award. There was a full page, in fact, two full page ads in the New York Times recognizing that distinction. So we can also celebrate that this evening. The Institute sponsors cultural events and promotes curriculum development, awards over $45,000 a year in scholarships to students pursuing coursework in Italian studies, and, as you well know, does a wonderful job of bringing outstanding Italian-related programming to the community, including the talk tonight. I'm also very happy to be introducing David Benetau. David is not only a member of the Arts and Sciences faculty, but he's also a colleague in my home department, the Department of Languages, Literatures, and Cultures. And as you'll see from the description of his interests, we have a lot of interests that overlap. He is the director of Italian Studies and currently interim director of the Obelger Institute. He's been at Seton Hall for 25 years, where he has taught Italian language, civilization, melodrama, and literature. He has taught in the Honors Program, Journey of Transformation in the University Corps, and Meeting the Other in the Corps as well, Great Books in the English Department, Contemporary American Literature to graduate students in China, Spanish as an adjunct in California, and even performed a Don Giovanni serenade on guitar at a Christmas party. And we wonder if we can persuade him to do that for us tonight, since he's talking about Don Giovanni. He has studied Italian, French, German, Spanish, Latin, medieval Latin, and Chinese, and he wrote this for me without mastering any of them. He is a medieval scholar and has published extensively on mercantile culture, but he also has a wide range of other interests. From his PhD preparation at the University of California, Berkeley, including Ovid, Voltaire — I'm a French scholar by training, so it's close to my heart — Shakespeare, Racine, and contemporary American and foreign novels, as well as art history, history, ceramics, music, and food culture. And that's another area where I share interests, both academic and culinary, with Dr. Benetau. So it's my pleasure to introduce him. He'll be speaking to us tonight about Don Giovanni's dinner party.
I'm going to speak about the history of Don Giovanni's myth and many elements which merged over four centuries to give us a nuanced version of his theme, open to different interpretations. I want to ask, why did these two artists choose this theme? And so there's a personal element there. I grew up in Italy, in Milan, and we're right near La Scala. I hope you all know La Scala is the center of all opera ever. And my mother was a huge fan. My mother is a huge fan. And I got introduced to concepts like honor. Rigoletto, Verdi, we lived right around the Verdi retirement home. Many years later, a good friend of mine, a student of mine from Berkeley, he fell in love with an opera star, and we went to opera a lot. My favorite opera in those times was Così fan tutte. So you're sure I'm going to mention that tonight too. Così fan tutte. We're all like that. Così fan tutte. My baby sister, while getting a PhD in math, decided to study Don Giovanni also. She took a class and she asked me, tragicomic, is it funny or is it sad? How can it be both? And so I just started working on that, thinking about that, and it turns out there's a whole lot of research done on Don Giovanni. And I've done a lot of that, and we're just going to scratch the surface today. There's lots and lots of things to say about that. I'm so happy to have everybody here. I'm overjoyed. In particular, can I see that my mentor, Peter R., right behind us? He was the director of honors back in the day. It's a great, great pleasure to have you. Obviously, everyone's welcome, and super welcome to this. So you are invited to Don Giovanni's dinner party. In the many different versions, the basic plot of Don Juan, and I use this name interchangeably, remains the same. A dashing young nobleman, Don is a title given to a nobleman in Spain, makes a sport of seducing as many women as he can at different stations without worrying about the means nor the consequences. He kills the father of one. In other versions, kidnaps women out of convents. He tricks and assaults women. Towards the end of the play, he encounters a speaking statue, the ghost of the man he has killed, and invites him to dinner. When the statue arrives, Don Juan is carried off into hell. The play is an excellent vehicle for stagecraft, dramatic action, supernatural dimension, ample opportunities for theatrics and special effects, sword fights, dramatic narrow escapes over walls, sensuous scenes, speaking statues, fires, and explosions. But by the way, you know this is at the Met right now? This particular scene is from the Met right now. It's performing right now as we speak almost. It's amazing. The play proved popular and thus has been earning authors and actors money in the theaters of the world ever since. Plays, operas, ballet, novels, and movies. The first written version of Don Juan we know is from Spain towards the end of the Spanish Golden Age in the first half of the 17th century. It was performed in three acts in front of a live audience in 1630. The author was a Spanish monk and popular playwright, Tirso de Molina. His play, written in rhyming verse, is entitled The Playboy of Seville and the Stone Guest, which already speaks to the dual nature of the play's interest. A main character intent on amusement and self-gratification, and an unlikely antagonist, a speaking statue, come to represent divine punishment. Don Juan is a classic moralizing play for the Counter-Reformation, which begins around 1560 in Italy, the Catholic reaction to Protestantism. Sin is ultimately punished. One disbelieves in God and his laws at one's own peril in this life and in eternity. In the insistence upon the risk of unbounded sexuality, one can easily read the church's discomfort at the increasingly lay character of the clergy, which the Counter-Reformation tried to stamp out. On the other hand, Don Juan is a prototypical Baroque hero, living for the moment, uncaring of yesterday or tomorrow, excessive and instinctive, fond of liberty, impatience with social constraints. He reflects the social and spiritual question of the era, and he denounces a world of hypocrisy in his quest for absolute liberty. For him, senses triumph over reason. Spanish theater audiences, largely illiterate in this century, recognizes themselves in comedy. Theater teaches us to proper behavior and morality, but also how to deal with others, with difficult situations, with the other sex, and also and provides us with an idealized portrait of ourselves. The male audience can easily identify with a lesson on seduction. The female audience can also revel in a portrait of themselves that is less one-dimensional than first meets the eye. In these days, marriages were usually arranged between families rather than based on romantic attraction. Wealthy families had to pay handsome dowries for their daughters. Sometimes, in the interest of getting the best possible marriage, the younger or less attractive daughters were sent to live in nunneries and destined to a life of being single. So perhaps the idea or fantasy of a tall, dark stranger kidnapping or saving you out of a life behind bars, or a lover younger and bolder than an older husband, whom you might not have wanted in the first place, had some attraction for female audience as well. Interestingly, the plays give a relatively permissive picture of women in their granting of affections before marriage, in a portrait some might have found unsettling. The humor mitigates this disturbing element, and we'll discuss this soon. And so we go to Italy. Yes. The 17th century in Italy saw an improvisational type of theater made by professional troops of actors, men and women, called the Commedia dell'arte. The term arte indicates a profession. Characters wore masks and were stock characters known to their audiences. Although many performances took place outdoors, such as in public squares or in front of churches, it is easier to make money from a play in a theater where you can sell tickets, and you might also sell the program, or the play itself in book form. The city where this type of theater flourished the most was Venice, in part because the city was not subject to the same level of censorship seen elsewhere. And so this particular one is from Prague, and look closely, 1776. There's only 1 year before Don Giovanni wrote his, indicating it's likely popular. And this might give us one little hint as to why they chose this topic. We'll come back in a second. The Commedia dell'arte relies heavily on improvisation. Gestures take precedent over text. Bubbly, funny, acrobatic, it transforms the relationship between the audience and the stage. Not bound to known rules, they boldly present body scenes, political satires, parodies, and critiques allowed by their interpretation. Their talent combines dance, song, buffoonery, and mime. The audience is enthusiastic and does not need to understand the language to participate in the intrigue, which is easily guessed. You might see that. I see the note there. Okay. In this type of theater, the notion of honor was less important. So the performing of Don Giovanni play is transformed into more comedian than dramatic form. One of Commedia dell'arte's significant contributions to this play is a much greater importance of the role of the servant, because the servant is a traditional vehicle of comedy in the Commedia dell'arte. A crowd favorite, an actor, but very often an acrobat, a character comically defined by constant hunger, cold, fear, and an interest in servant girls. The servant becomes the spokesman of an ideology opposed to social order, with an unusual combination of smarts, ignorance, honesty, and vulgarity. He represents every man. In this lyric opera, Leporello becomes a clear parody of his master, which we see from the very first scene where he says, "I want to be a gentleman, I don't want to serve." We have evidence of many different stages of Don Giovanni's in Italy, usually under the name Il Convitato di Pietra, the stone guest. And what they have in common is that the serious and religious message of the play has been complemented, if not entirely erased, by comedy. Although the ending remains the same, the dialogue is in comic register, highlighted by the continuing banter between Don and his servant. The unwritten versions of the play haven't come down to us, of course, but we know about them through the many critics who took exception to the coarseness of the staging, with, for example, bathroom jokes and general rudeness, which satirizes all the characters in the play. The seduced women for their foolishness, the nobles for their pretensions, the servants for their stupidity. All the characters, that is, except for Don Giovanni. Later written versions cleaned out the perceived vulgarity of Commedia dell'arte's performances, as we see in Ciccolini's version. Don Giovanni gradually becomes more of an atheist, and the connection between atheism and the libertine lifestyle becomes firmly entrenched. The stone guest radically rethinks the religious and moral dimension of the original play, converting it into a more entertaining play. Still, it maintains the pedagogic happy ending, happy, not happy for Don Giovanni, but for the rest of us, a punishment, and mourns about unbounded sexual freedom and refusal to believe, despite lack of evidence, in the existence of the afterlife. In Ciccolini's time, plays were part of popular entertainment that includes acrobatic shows, showmanship, musical performances. This is probably when the Don Juan play began to be associated with music. The second half of the 17th century marks the ascension of France. It is the greatest period of French letters, hands down. Do you agree? He does. This was the age of the Sun King, Louis XIV. He patronizes France's three greatest playwrights, among which the master of comedy, Molière. It's with Molière that the myth of Don Juan takes its first great literary form. A full character breaks with conventions and traditional rules of society, giving us a complex view of human relations and institutions. Here, the Don Juan is a multi-angled portrayal of the main character, whose personality and qualities are contrasted with those of his servant, also very present, Sgaranet, played by Molière himself. He has many attractive qualities. Don Giovanni, handsome, eloquent, witty, brave, independent from social constraints. To minimize the negativity, Molière represents his misdeeds mostly off stage. For example, the murder predates the play. Assaults are staged behind the screen and can be heard but not seen. The pervasive ambiguity is a source of interest and nuance in which aesthetics and ethics clash. The viewer's pleasure of sensational misbehavior, especially for young men, is challenged by gradual descent into hypocrisy and dislike, followed by the punitive ending which Don Juan deserves. Molière's Don Juan is a play about hypocrisy, not only the main characters, but the society he lampoons and its empty conventions. He serves the role of laying bare the falsity of aristocratic behavior. Molière skewers the feudal concept of honor. Don Juan embodies the decadent nobleman, idle, extravagant, depraved. Don Juan explicitly becomes a libertine. And he is the embodiment. He becomes the embodiment of this third term for European audiences. Originally, the term libertine expressed a free thinker, free from the precepts of religion and opposed to received ideas, free to make his own ideas about the world. The term gradually changed to express first an explicit atheist, then someone free to act in any way he chooses, independently of social institutions, ethics, or morality. A major feature of the libertine is his passion for gambling. And the foremost example of this is the Venetian aristocrat Giacomo Casanova, whose life was remarkably similar to Don Giovanni's myth.
Oh yeah, he's a Casanova.
And guess what? Casanova and Da Ponte knew each other. And they might have been friends. And they were kind of dangerous friends in those days. You have to be careful who your friends were exactly in Venice. At the end of the Republic of Venice was a dangerous time. They both lived through the French Revolution. The exaltation of human freedom in nature clashes with the political and social needs of the day. One social institution subverted and mocked by Don Juan is marriage. Recall that during this time, it had no administrative reason or contract. It was only a religious rite. Therefore, an atheist and a libertine could be in agreement as to its unnecessity. Clandestine marriages and elopements were frequent. Thus, Don Juan can promise to marry a woman and thereby seduce them by taking advantage of their credulity, as in the following lines in Molière.
You tell me he married your mistress. Rest assured that he would have done more for his passion, and that with her. He would also have married you, her dog, and her cat.
Here is another example of the brilliant repartee Molière is celebrated for, in which Don Juan critiques monogamy in an almost lawyerly tone.
Do you ask that one should tie oneself to the first lovely object that catches our eye, that we renounce the world for that? No, no. All beauties have the right to charm us, and the good fortune of meeting first should not steal from others the rights they have to our affections. The love I have for one doesn't force me to be unjust to all the others.
In other words, if you're faithful to one, you are cheating on all the others. Do the math. The laugh is never on him, and the societal traditions are not taken too seriously. Therefore, can he be seen as an anti-establishment hero to some? Gradually, comedy comes to embrace every aspect of the play. His amateur exploits are regularly interrupted. In coitus interruptus also lies the comedy. The origin of comedy comes also from non-communication. Characters speaking in different registers. The failed emotion of his betrayed wife in Vera, we'll see in a minute, versus the man deaf to that. The different social classes squaring off between the servant and the man. Really speaks different languages. The ultimate metaphor of this miscommunication is when a man speaks to a statue and the statue responds. This might remind you of Ovid, a Greek myth, Pygmalion. You know the story? The artist creates a statue because he doesn't like people, and she's so beautiful that he falls in love with her. And then she comes alive. That's Pygmalion. In Paris, there was a theater of Italian-style comedy known as Commedie à l'Italienne, in which Molière was a great fan. Playing along Molière's troupe, the Italian comedians were for him an incontestable influence. Molière incorporates a movement and rhythm directly descended from the Commedia dell'arte. The person playing the captive audience is his servant, by now structural necessity for the play. The master Italian artist, Domenico Biancolelli, played Arlecchino, the servant. He was Louis XIV's favorite Italian actor. Molière asked Biancolelli to translate the Italian version of Don Juan for him. The Italian Commedia Postient pushed the envelope too far and were expelled from France for making fun of a woman close to the king. Note Molière also risked, and his play, Il Tartuffe, had to close down after only one performance, only after the first performance, because too risky to religious powers, even though the king liked it. He skewered religious hypocrisy, he claimed, not belief. And so, take a deep breath. Finally, took him a while to get here. A lyric opera is a play put to music where there are parts spoken or semi-sung, punctuated often by difficult music pieces known as arias. Opera flourished in the 17th century, sometimes out of a simple form known as melodrama, drama in music. Probably Don Giovanni's most famous artistic representation was composed in only a few weeks in 1787 by the Italian librettist Lorenzo da Ponte, who I've loved to death, and Mozart, whom everybody loves. the Italian language opera Don Giovanni. It is one of the most famous and accessible operas of all time. It continues to be playing in opera house around the world. Made many people rich, we're about to see in a minute. It was a unique cooperation. The artists worked together, phrase by phrase, and wrote three amazing lyric operas in rapid succession. They even argued that Ponte didn't like the overture of Don Giovanni, written single day. He found it too dark. And so imagine doing something like this in 3 weeks. It's just mind-boggling to think that you could create something like this. You know, it would take us 10 years to do something similar. We know from various sources that the audience of the Settecento had grown tired of the often repeated performance of the play known as the Stone Guest. Consider it plebeian and often vulgar amusement. Tonight we're going to try to understand why our two great artists chose this theme with little prestige, especially after the extraordinary success of The Marriage of Figaro, which, when they performed that, the crowd went crazy. They were not expecting this incredible popularity. In lyric opera, music fans listening. In lyric opera, poetic truth lies in its musical form. Music has an emotional impact presented differently from emotion expressed only in written words. Music provides an entirely different dimension to the text because of its ability to move empathy in a deeper way. Musical forms also carry meaning, such as comic set pieces we will see from the following examples. The catalog and the invitation to dinner. Written in a set rhythm, the audiences would understand as traditionally comic. The music itself is a vehicle for comedy and empathy. Mozart's opera Don Giovanni is called the Dramma Giocoso, they called it. A playful drama. Later, Mozart changed, he referred to it as an opera buffa. This is not the same thing, these are two different things. A playful drama, the theme of the punished dissolute is formed by the conflict between two structural elements. The pedagogic drama from Counter-Reformation and the comedy of human imperfections in all its natural instincts. It can be seen as a summa of all preceding elements. From Spain come the supernatural, religious, and erotic elements. From Italy, commedia, the rhythm, the social and parodic elements, such as the servants. From France, the sharp critique made from brilliant repartee, then reshaped by some of the most beautiful music ever written. The authors of Don Giovanni reduced the number of characters to 7 from 14, highlighted the contrast between the servant and the master, put the murder early in the second scene to highlight the drama, put sexual activity backstage, comically interrupted. The character's negativity is downplayed. His seduction of a simple woman is sung to the chaste style. That's where we will hold our hands. He's challenged to a duel by the elderly father of a woman he has dishonored, but he kills in self-defense. The servant, though he harbors significant reservations, admires him and attempts to imitate him in comically misdirected seductions. Don Giovanni's exaggerated sexual appetite is presented comically as in the celebrated aria of the catalog, il catalogo, Madamina il catalogo è questo, the long list of the 1,800 women Don Giovanni has seduced. Now, hopefully this is not as loud as I wanted. This is from a spectacular film made by Peter Lucy. We only have time for a little bit of it. And unfortunately, it's not very loud, but here it is. Listen in. Listen for the jokes.
Thank you.
Have to stop something like that, so I would not be disappointed by that. The original foolish character of the betrayed woman is a stock character from 17th century theater. Legend has it, and I believe it, that a singer in Vienna, a true diva, refused to perform unless she was given a difficult aria in which to showcase her skills in the second act also. And this was added at the last minute. It's hard to believe that you could do something like this. It became one of Mozart's most famous arias, in which the woman's heart and willingness to forgive rise above her anger. When you first meet her, she says, "I want to cut his heart out." It's hard to believe him in the other. The great humanity of this piece shined brightly in the warm voice of New Zealand's adopted Māori soprano, Kiri Te Kanawa. Note how the music, now, listen carefully, the music and aria changes how we interpret the myth, seeing it from the complex angle of the betrayed woman's heart. This aria changes our interpretation of Don Giovanni. Don Juan as a lover fails, but does he succeed as a man? Moving from one object to another, he is incapable of finding love, turning into a real human being. Thus, he is not human, and ultimately, he cannot garner our sympathy. He desperately needs an audience. So what ultimately is our reaction to the ideas embedded in this myth? Do we still harbor perhaps a mix of admiration for his flaunting of social roles? Can he be considered today as an anti-establishment hero? In the Romantic period, there's one Don Giovanni where he willingly walks into the flames rather than repent. This modern day reconsideration of gender issues can't help but invite us to view this from different historical perspectives. What is the connection between the roles people play as man or woman and lover? What differences does this ask us to think about? The many different modern portrayals of characters and situations in the Don Juan mold are multifaceted. Women Don Giovanni, black or Hispanic characters, politically conscious interracial casting, such as Peter Sellers' 1989 version of twin black singers for Don Giovanni and Le Borello. This figure was created by our assumptions about masculinity dependent upon our assumptions of femininity. And these changed throughout the centuries, and here in this performance by the diva. Note how masculinity is defined differently in the different portrayals of Don Giovanni. In Tirso, he's superior, noble, rich, and abusive, domineering, militaristic. In Molière, he's smart and opportunist, uncaring, but also free from social conventions. The Italian comedic representations highlight how handsome he is, a show-off, in need of an audience, but also insecure, only partially successful. Finally, in the operatic version, probably more familiar to Western audiences, he is bombastic, exuberant, blind to the obvious, and to the needs of others. And so here is one existential reading of Don Giovanni, a man living to become a master of his world. He comes out of the Enlightenment in newly empowered women and is trying to redefine himself just before the French Revolution as someone above social conventions. He is doomed by his shortcomings. The myth of Don Juan, in all its fun on stage and in music, in all its laughter and fears, gives us a mirror of ourselves. Becoming master of the world is only a stage illusion. And now let's go back to the original version of the opera without the aria of love and forgiveness that Elvira gives. Let's try to reinterpret this. Let's try to make a second conclusion to this, another way of reading this play. In the statue episode, the supernatural events charge of fear intended to terrify the Baroque audience. And if you go to the Met and you see that fire, believe me, the firemen are terrified of that. It is only maintained comically in the character of the serpent. The nobleman has no fear, having fun trying to scare the serpent. In the playful duet on two registers with comic lines, the music gives playful tone to the whole episode. Note the clever nod the movie director Losi has made to the significance of the episode. Don Giovanni doesn't look at the speaking statue directly. He symbolically refuses to face the possibility of another reality beyond the material world of our senses.
Oh,
And so, ladies and gentlemen, we are now at the dinner party, just before the last two scenes. This scene has a long history of themes and comic motifs based upon three dinner ingredients. Number one, the hunger of the servant. Number two, the theft of dinner. And the musical request of the master. The theme of food lends itself especially well to comedy. In general, servants can't eat, and with envy they watch the master eat and drink with gusto. Now, do you remember Biancolelli that I was telling you earlier? Biancolelli Alecchino, he was the master of the celebrated theft capon in those days, not pheasant, from behind the back of the master using a fishing hook. He would steal some bites from the master's plate. Look away. Try to picture this. There's none of that here, unfortunately. And so listen to this. I wrote, the nobleman has a band that plays for him during dinner. And I've seen this about 20 times. No, maybe 50 times. And I just watched it again, and I realized the nobleman has two bands that play for him during his dinner. You might see them coming in. This band reflects the orchestra making from the principal character a listener like us. Okay, so try to follow.
Thank you.
Continues to change the canzonetta. In its recognition, you find numerous jokes. The first two, unique. Le Corano remarks, a double meaning. First, an unusual selection. Unique, unusual. The second thing, this is a citation, Da Ponte's own libretto, titled The Faithfulness of Women, is unique. The second thing, how do you like the music, asked Don Giovanni. It's worthy of your methods, says Don Giovanni, meaning, no, I don't like the music. The second canzonetta, Hooray for the Litigants, refers to the two characters, Don Giovanni and Leporello themselves, in constant debate, and this coincides with the theft of dinner. The self-reference is obvious with the third canzonetta, from Figaro, which are artists heard played on the street by street musicians on their way to eat breakfast. This one I know all too well, he says bitterly. I'm afraid I know this one, I wish I didn't. Then the master notices the theft and catches Leporello by making him whistle. And here, my friends, you might catch the key to the whole episode. You might find a reading of the whole story in the witty and innocent answer. That of the servant, also from Figaro, by the way. So excellent is your cook. I wanted to taste it. That is, I couldn't resist. But led me to this, and the opportunity. Is the opportunity and the quality of the object, and thus the pleasure of tasting it. The choice of Leporello, parody of his owner, interpreter of the crime through the theft of the pheasants, parody of the victims, and an explanation of his crime, serves like an epicurean defense. It was a useless resistance, which is the name then. This painting was shown in recent sensational art exhibit in Boston entitled Casanova, The Seduction of Europe. We have that book here. I'm afraid I've been kidnapped in my car upstairs. But see, my class is an amazing exhibit. And so, I read the artist's choice of the myth of Don Giovanni as follows. A symbol of human passions, seeing its ambiguous fascination where aesthetics and ethics clash. By enjoying the band, that playing along makes the character a listener like us, spectator, and we become participants while laughing in his moral choices and his pleasure. Our artists have seduced their audiences by making us laugh. Only then, increasing our enjoyment by recognizing musical themes, by laughing, can we fully obtain with entirety the understanding and the musical memories, theatrical and existential, which these artists gave us. And only then, if we can learn to recognize our own humanity in all its limits, its natural imperfections, only then can we appreciate and celebrate the greatness of humanity. And I'm going to close from citation from Così fan tutte. We're all like that. Don Alfonso, the organizer of the plot, asks, if we place a bet on dinner, and I can prove to you that we are imperfect, that women can be unfaithful to their lovers, and we still love them. If so, can we still be friends? Might I also be invited to the dinner party? Sarà un giro dei convitati. Thank you. It's about what's funny, not funny, the woman gets Rigoletto. Anybody know Rigoletto? Yes. So the character, she gets dishonored, and then she gets killed. And she's stabbed and strangled, and she's put in a bag, and then they throw the bag in a river. And then her father finds her, and he opens the bag, and she sings a song after that. And so that is opera for you. That's a little drama right there, the last thing there. Okay, so thank you. I'd like the student to ask a couple questions, please.
There's a Sicilian opera.
What sort of social repercussions did this have for women at the time?
The opera like this, this is a super interesting question. So first of all, Duke Castrato was a man singer who has been emasculated. They were adults and children, and because women were not welcome on stage. The interesting thing about Commedia dell'arte is they're women. Women were not allowed to be. If we're in a good family and our daughter wants to act, you know, could be horrified. And so that whole complication starts a lot earlier than we realized. Thank you very much, Dr. Pleasure to have you. In terms of the audience, I wonder how common it was for women to go alone to the theater like this, or whether they would only go under supervision.
Sure.
Where's the wife? That's a super interesting question, Angelina. I don't really answer. Very interesting, though.
Thank God.
Should they know
that
George Bernard Shaw wrote a sequel to Don Giovanni, Don Juan, and Cal? Not existing play.
And of course, Pygmalion, of course, that is always a wonderful theme. Another thing is Da Ponte. So, students, did you notice anything about the dates that I gave of people's lives? Did you notice anything about that? Like how many people were cited? Did you notice anything about their lives?
Not long.
It was not many people who really lived to be old. Okay? And one of those people is Da Ponte. Da Ponte, he went bankrupt about four times. He lost two wives and most of his family. Influenza, and he's a terrible businessman, and so he left Italy. By the way, he was Jewish, and then he was a Catholic, and he became a monk. Yep, and then he was almost arrested as a monk for sexual activity while all this stuff. We don't have time to talk about that now. He moved to America. Then you know where he lived? Closer.
New York.
Elizabeth Town.
Oh, wow.
Elizabeth Town means Elizabeth.
Elizabeth.
Yeah. Elizabeth. Wow. He was bankrupt. He felt completely disrespected. He thought, oh my goodness, what have I done in my life? And then finally, late in life, he was recognized. And he became a professor at Columbia University. Wow. Da Ponte was, and then all of a sudden, the Mozart craze began, and he was a superstar late in life, like many, many, many great artists. Most of their lives were lived in poverty. Mozart lived very shortly.
Very interesting.
Please.
I have a comment, but I don't want to step on any toes.
No. Introduce yourself, Paul.
Okay. I'm Paul Christensen. I teach music history and theory here. Thank you for this wonderful talk. Amazing. So I have a couple of things that just occurred to me. You mentioned Castrati. I don't know if people know, but there's actually a recording of the last castrato. You can actually hear the castrato sound.
Oh, really?
Actually, very bizarre. It's called the last castrato. It's a CD. Alessandro Moreschi. He died at 1922, something like that. And this was recorded. That's one aspect. But I wanted to get back to Don Giovanni, where I'm thinking a little bit, it seems like a morality play, a little bit, because the earlier version, I can't remember the name of the gentleman, who had Il Dissoluto, but Mozart has, or Da Ponte has, Il Dissoluto Punito, and that seems a very important thing. because when I'm teaching about marriage and figure out to my students, I talk about social critique of Mozart, because at this time, in Mozart's time, composers were considered servants. I mean, well-treated servants, but servants. They're definitely servants. And he chafed at that idea that he was a servant, and he was somehow, they were his betters. He didn't like that. So that the social critique of Figaro, it seems to me, it could be a social critique also of Don Giovanni. I don't know.
Yeah, very interesting. And so the singers felt that they had power over the composer. Okay, there were no copyrights, right? If I could write this down, believe me, I can play it, then I'm not going to pay you for doing it in these days. And then a singer would refuse to perform. That's very surprising, and not surprising. It's very interesting also. Thank you, please.
I had taken a class, and they talked about Platone Mobile, and they said, the professor at that time said that when they wrote that song, they knew that it was going to be really popular, so they did it in secret because of the musician, the traveling, other singers would steal it, and you would hear it everywhere. They wanted it to be not known at the opening, and that was a big, big secret. I don't know if you ever heard that.
It's not a bit surprising. Now, Verdi lives in a much later Italy, okay? Risorgimento, a lot of stuff that he writes is political. Aida and the like is full of the exile of the Hebrews. That is about Italy under Austro-Italian power, okay? And so he did not get married to the woman that he loved. And for that he was looked upon very poorly by many people. They disliked that a lot. And that's another interesting thing, yes?
What I always find to be most fascinating and very difficult about Don Giovanni is that every time I watch a new production or hear a new production CD, I always feel like I'm watching and listen to a new opera, a different opera. Now, the core is the same. However, the relationship between the characters can be interpreted in so many ways. Take the servant and Don Giovanni, for example. I've seen opera where they are friends, and yet some are much more master and servant like. What is this about?
Yes.
I'm trying to get into the original intent of Mozart and La Fonte.
Yeah.
Now, did they do this on purpose? That is so adaptable. Yes.
Those are two super questions. I'll take the second one first. They don't think of it as theirs anymore, okay? You're not gonna make any more money from this, okay? Basically, we only make money if we can perform it. And there's no sales and anything like that. That's the first thing. That's the first question. That's your second question. So the first question, if you are a singer now, do you feel that you need to reinterpret the song in your own novel way? Or are you happy with just repeating the classical way it's done? And this is the debate. This is the difference between classic and anti-classical things. Anti-classical, romantic, baroque, they want to break the rules. They want to push the envelope, so to speak. And they would do that differently. And so imagine a woman playing Don Giovanni. Imagine a modern version of that, where there's aides. Don Giovanni as a singer in a modern way. He's a very bad guy. And that's a very different interpretation of it. People want to do that. Many people think, people sometimes say that's an opera I'd like to go see, I'd like to go hear, and close my eyes. Because they hate the modern clothes and all of that. Many people, I've heard that, said numerous times. Yes, I want to see it, but I'm going to keep my eyes closed during that opera. Are you a classicist or are you a romantic? What period are you in? You like Beethoven at La Scala? We saw Fidelio from Beethoven, you cried for an hour. It really tugs on your heart. Go ahead.
I plead you to be one of those people who very often Don Giovanni, I would close my eyes. Because the music is just, it gets you. The different interpretation, however, between the characters, I find it very difficult sometimes to comprehend. Because it takes seeming little while to hear, okay, why is Donna O'Farrell this way, and why is Elena such a, like, a bombshell?
Yeah.
So I plead guilty. I'm very often.
I join you.
Thank you.
For both guilty.
Thank you very much.
Martha, please speak up.
Would you say that the appreciation for the play increased after the addition of the more complex female character by the female audience? Because before that, the female characters, yes, they fall in love, like they're unfaithful, and they're shown not to just marry for out of like the contractual that they're forced to. But still, when they're in love, when they fall for Don Giovanni, it's always kind of a trick. So I would say those are still kind of one-dimensional. She's the first character that's a little bit more, you know, she forgives him, like there's more of a journey with her. Would you say that the female audience increased after the addition of that specific character?
Absolutely, not only the female character, I think more depth, you know, makes it more approachable, makes it more open to different interpretations also. It's a magnificent aria. You know, nobody can say, oh my goodness, you know, that doesn't belong. You can't take exception to that. It's another useless resistance.
Let's move. Can we take a more sober interpretation of this whole thing? I think there's way too much, in my opinion, going on here. Because it's an opera full of hyperboles, and that's what makes it a comedy. This is laughable, right? In a certain sense. And I haven't heard too much of that here today, right? I mean, it's supposed to be funny. And it's making fun of us, a society that existed at that time. Through the use of hyperboles.
Yes.
Could I just add, though, that when I think of the overture, to Marriage of Figaro, which is definitely a comedy, and I think the overture to Don Giovanni, it's very ominous at the beginning, extremely ominous, and especially when it comes back later in diminished chords when Commendatore makes his appearance. So, yeah, there's comedy, but it is kind of like a dark comedy.
Yeah.
I mean, like not just slapstick, oh, that's hilarious, but you know what I mean? Like,
I didn't say slapstick.
Yeah, no, I didn't even say that. Not that much. Yeah.
Thank you all so much. It's been long, spectacular, wonderful day. It's been a lot of effort has gone into this. I'm really super rewarded by seeing so many people, the students in particular. You're released. Please sign there and then run over to the buffet because the dinner began at 7 p.m. Thank you all so much. Thank you.